Let me welcome Amisha Patel, who's the Executive Director of the Grassroots Collaborative, and John Schur, Director of State Fiscal Strategies for the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities. And I don't remember who is going first. Amisha? Okay, your slides are here. Great. So welcome, Amisha Patel.
Hey, good morning. So I work for Grassroots Collaborative. We're a community labor coalition that works on economic and racial justice issues. I'm going to talk about how we actually, what the setup was to get us here. Some of this kind of echoes what you've already heard, so I'll move through some pieces a little quicker and really end on talking about how people can plug in, what do we do to take action. So we actually where we just ended in our last talk, right? This question of who has a higher tax burden, a home care worker or our dear governor. And it really does, this is not there. Okay. It depends, you know, the highest income, highest burden of taxes really does hit the lowest income people the hardest. Illinois is a great state for the wealthiest, right? There's only 10 states better where you've got a lower tax burden versus the lowest income people in the state, which is, it's one of the worst states to live in if you don't have money. And, you know, I don't think we can talk about this budget crisis without talking about income inequality and what's been happening, of course, over a set of decades. This chart is really kind of says it all. It's from my colleague here at the Center for Budget and Policy Priorities. When we do workshops with this, we usually actually, before we show this chart, we have a set of volunteers who take anywhere from 18 to 27, or 1 to 27 steps forward based on the income percentile that they represent. And it really is a stark visualization of the fact of skyrocketing income inequality, that the top 1% in that exercise literally go out the door. So part of how wealth is being concentrated, of course, is really directly connected to tax rates. It's not just that the wealthiest are the ones who are the hardest workers and have been able to, like, you know, win in this economy. There have been rigging tax laws to help them continue to get ahead. This shows the tax rates falling over for the top 0.1 and top 0.01%, which in 1945 literally was at 55% to 60%. They get taxed. Right now it's in 23-25% tax rates for our highest income taxpayers. So one piece of this story is looking at what the impact has been around how tax policies has really continued to benefit the richest people in this country. But also, I think what we have to also look and understand is how individual taxpayers versus corporations have what the change in share has looked like over the set of over a period of time. So what this chart shows, the blue line is the corporate income tax. The red line is the share of individuals. And so what you see is that around, you know, in the 30s, it was about half and half, that half of across federally, 50% of our federal tax dollars came from individuals and 50% from corporations. And now it's about 85 and 15, right? 85% of taxes are being paid by individuals. And you take this back to those charts that I just showed, is that it's actually in that burden, though, still is on the lowest income and middle income taxpayers. The highest income taxpayers aren't actually paying their fair share. But you add in this piece about corporations and how corporate income taxes have been steadily decreasing. Again, it didn't just happen this way. There are laws that are being passed. There are policies that are being created that continue to benefit corporate America. But here's the thing. So then they're paying very little, but then they, of course, continue to try to dodge the remaining taxes that are left. And we can look at this by very legal offshore tax shelters. And these are annual losses of combined federal and state losses in billions. California is the first state, then New York, Texas, Florida, and then there's Illinois. So for folks who can't see in the back, that is $8.5 billion annually that Illinois does not collect because of offshore tax shelters. So some people are having a really good time, right, benefiting from this. And if you're referring back to some of the numbers that you've heard today, that's right about what the actual deficit is currently in the state of Illinois. When we talk about there's no way to get there and how to fix this, obviously fixing offshore tax shelters is a long-term thing, but I think the point of this is to say there is money, right? It's about where that money is actually going and the priorities of the policymakers in deciding where that money goes. So as corporate taxes have been going down, again, that chart where you saw the share of corporate taxes going down, what happens is that government borrowing has been going up. So we're actually at about $4 trillion of borrowing. It's been skyrocketing because, again, if you don't have money, what do? We borrow. So basically, the rich corporations and banks, by not paying their fair share of taxes, force the government to cut programs and borrow, then make a profit when we borrow from them, going back to those banks, and then tell us that we've got to live within our means, and then they cut even more. So I'm actually going to go over this really quickly. We all know that the cuts are affecting our communities in lots of very concrete and specific ways. There still remains about 10,000 families who don't have access to childcare. Energy assistance has been slashed. Higher ed has a piece that has been, I think, barely talked about in terms of the impact on higher education in the state. 130,000 students that depend on MAP grants are... don't have that money. And immigration support services have been completely slashed, right? So there's multiple ways that families are being impacted by these cuts. But we know that there are some people benefiting. Not everyone is hurting in this time. So, of course, there's our governor. Anyone know who the other man is? Ken Griffin, the head of Citadel, the richest man in Illinois. So when that temporary income tax rolled back, our governor is saving now $767,000 a year in his income taxes that he's not paying. And Ken Griffin, over $16 million, right? What could our programs do with one man's saved income taxes? What could that $16 million do for our communities? So I want to talk a little bit more about, so that's kind of all income side, right? But we also know that there's bad bank and corporate deals that are also costing us millions, actually even in one case, billions of dollars that we should fight. And I want to talk about one really quickly, and that's toxic interest rate swaps. So some people might have heard this. It's been in the news a bunch. The Tribune ran a set of series. Sun Times recently as well. And actually, this week was a big week around this because, as people know, Rahm Emanuel was trying to push $3 billion in borrowing through the city council. And some Progressive Caucus aldermen actually fought back against $106 million of that. It's not a huge amount in that large total $3 billion. But it's significant because that $106 million was voluntary payouts to banks that the mayor was trying to push out. Voluntarily handing our money over to banks in this time of crisis, right? And we were able to stop that at least for a month. But I'm going to talk a little bit about what these things are. And so these toxic interest rate swaps, goodness, bear with me. I'm not an economist, but I have learned a lot about all of this, so everyone can. So toxic swaps, right? So what happens is that the government, so Illinois, Chicago Public Schools, have all bought into these deals. So any one of those entities borrows money through bonds and pays interest on the loan, right? So they can either pay a fixed rate or a variable rate. Variable rate, of course, there's a benefit of that because it starts lower at the beginning. But the fixed rate, of course, allows you to have some stability. So governments also like to have the stability in terms of being able to plan for their budgets. So in these toxic swaps, the state borrows money through a variable rate bond. So the interest we pay back to those investors, that means like they go up and down. So bankers came around, though, selling a deal to say, let's make a side bet, which is the swap. So every month, the bank and state send each other checks. The bank sends a check at a variable rate, and the state sends a check at a fixed rate. So that's the swap. And so in theory, right, that the idea was that, oh, this will all balance out over the end of period of time. The state will get the benefit of having a reliable amount of money that they have to pay, and over time it would pretty much add up to what they would have paid anyway. So that was the deal, right? Sounds okay, right? So if I was in the room, I'd be like, hey, that doesn't sound so bad. But what really happened to interest rates around 2008? They crashed, right? So when banks crash the economy and we bail them out, their interest rates go down to near 0%, yet now we're locked into paying 4 to 6% on these swap deals. So that difference between what we're paying and what the banks now are paying is all the profit that the banks have been making. Those are our tax dollars that are going to the banks instead of going to our communities. So they sold us a bad deal. And the state can't just walk away from them. These are legal agreements. And what the banks are really smart, they built in termination penalties that make them fully whole to say, fine, if you change your mind, you still have to pay us the full amount that you would have owed us anyway. Great deal, right? But the thing is, we actually could fight to get out of them. And the problem is that we don't have anyone yet who's fighting back, at least not the folks completely in charge. And so this idea of laws and what we file a lawsuit on is very questionable, right? Because we can close schools, we can cut pensions, we can cut neighborhood services. Why can't we fight hard against the banks that are just destroying our communities? And so that's what we're pushing for, right, is that we've got a lot of power as taxpayers in the city and in Chicago Public Schools and certainly in the state. So why aren't we saying that, you know what, if a bank doesn't renegotiate with us on these deals, we're going to put you at the last of the line in terms of doing more new business with the state or city or Chicago Public Schools? Why is it that we're not trying to actually sue the banks? Because it is pretty clear that they did not reveal the full risks of these deals, which is grounds for a lawsuit, grounds for legal action. Other places have done this and have recouped literally millions of dollars back. The amount of swaps that we've taken in could recoup much, much more money. So I'm going to talk about one bank alone, Bank of America. Just one of the banks, right, has taken $120 million so far, $18 million in 2015, and projected over the life of these deals $337 million. Again, what could that do? What community services, what education funding, what health services could we be providing with the amount of money that instead we're giving to the banks? We could have fully funded child care assistance program in fiscal year 2015. But they tell us there's no money for working people, right? So I want to just talk quickly about two different paths, and we've heard a little bit about other states, Minnesota and Wisconsin, and this, I think, is an interesting tale of two governors. We've got Governor Mark Dayton, who did raise taxes on the 1%, generating $1.3 billion annually. So he increased credits, low-income tax credits, increased funding for education. On top of that, actually raised the minimum wage. Governor Scott Walker, of course, cut taxes on the wealthy, cut low-income tax credits, and cut programs in healthcare. And what's happened, right? They are actually, they're fairly, of course, they're different states. There's lots of variables, but there is a lot to compare themselves with. Minnesota, in that same period of time, created 20,000 more jobs. Their unemployment rate fell faster. But I think the biggest thing is that Minnesota is trying to figure out what to do with their $1.5 billion surplus, right? It's a different, I would like to have that problem. Wisconsin, of course, has a $1.8 billion deficit. You raise revenue in progressive revenue, you have more money to fund the community services that you need. So we do have a choice in which direction that we're going to go. So I want to end on talking about a few different solutions. So millionaires tax, we've already voted for it. In fact, we voted more of us voted for it than we did our governor. And it would be a 3% surcharge potentially on our income tax rate to be able to, again, generate money from the wealthiest people in the state. A lot of us are working on a fair tax campaign, right? And so this is, again, as heard earlier, 8 states in the country that don't have, that do have a flat income tax. We're one of them. And if the wealthiest paid their fair share, we generate literally billions of dollars. It's a no-brainer. Closing corporate loopholes. Only 8% of state revenue comes from corporate income taxes. So that federal chart that I showed of the line of individual share versus corporation share, we're below that. That's a national, those are national numbers. So we're not even close to the average of that. So we only get 8% of our revenue from corporate income taxes. And a big part of that is that two-thirds of Illinois corporations don't pay anything at all. $700 million annually could be restored by closing corporate income tax loopholes. One example is Boeing's tax rate, 0%. Because, you know, they're struggling and they don't have any money to pay taxes. Ending bad bank deals is another campaign that's happening. The collaborative is working on this. And again, this is the going after these toxic swaps that the state of Illinois literally has will lose about $1 billion in these deals through toxic swaps, right? So our demand is that the Attorney General Lisa Madigan, sue the banks, recoup these deals that we push to make banks who are unwilling to renegotiate to go to the back of the line, put families first and banks last. Financial transaction tax, this is National Nurses United and other groups are leading this effort to try to have a small tax on high-speed trading that could raise about $1 billion, if not more. But I also want to talk a little bit about tactics, right? So those are some campaigns that are going on. There's lots of people working to try to actually build power, you know, move forward an agenda that actually starts to change the dynamics. Some of the upcoming tactics, the Responsible Budget Coalition is leading a state of our state address in advance of the governor's state of the state address, and we'll be presenting the state of our state the day before the governor's address, and then we'll be doing a big rally in Springfield. There likely will be a Chicago rally that afternoon as well. There's Moral Mondays led by Fair Economy Illinois, which is really a group of faith leaders and lay leaders coming together to make the connections around the budget crisis and the folks that are benefiting from that budget crisis that you are often in action, another way for folks to plug in. And the work of the collaborative, we're leading what we're calling an equity budget. And so that is in the mayor's and the governor's budget address in February, we're going to release in advance of his budget address our equity budget. Again, what are we for? What is that? What would it take to get there? What would it look like to move more towards better funding of our community services, our education, and our health care? We're doing leadership trainings on the economy. This is a very quick version of what we're doing with low-income leaders and middle-income leaders across the state, but around understanding how we actually got to this moment, because it is a setup. And we can't keep demanding to stop the cuts. That's been our demand for years, and yet we still keep getting cut. Right, so our belief is that we've actually got to understand how this works and then change our demands to tax the rich, close corporate loopholes, and end bad bank deals. And another piece that we're going to do is bank actions on the 1st and the 15th of the month. People may not know this, but the state pays the banks in full the 1st and the 15th of every single month, including payments that they actually legally are not obligated to make. Yet again, how many social service providers are not getting funded in this moment, right? It's a scandal that people don't know about. We're going to be organizing to make it more of a scandal. Part of that is our website, whogotpaid.org, that shows, it's a ticker of how much money we're giving to the banks, has some stories around the impact in this moment of the budget crisis. So I think that's where I'll end. So that's, you know, I think the main point is that there is a lot of organizing work. There are lots of ways for people to plug in, lots of organizations in motion, and people should join in any way that they can. Thank you.
I was going to say good morning, but it looks like I can say good afternoon. Hi, everybody. Thank you for coming, because if you're here, you care. And not everybody does, so that's a great thing. I'm coming here from Washington, D.C. I've heard a lot about the problems in Illinois, and I feel a lot better about them today, just hearing the things that have been said today, a lot of good stuff. And I'll see if I can add to some of it and reinforce some of it. I work at the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities in Washington, D.C. We do this kind of work all around the country. And one of the things I get to do is work with a network of organizations in 42 states called the State Priorities Partnership. And I want to do a real quick shout out to the group from Illinois, the Fiscal Policy Center at Voices for Illinois Children, and their two brand new policy analysts are here today, Mitch Lifson and Leslie Helmkamp. So welcome to them. Well, it's nice to be someplace where you got invited because people want you to talk about taxes. That doesn't happen everywhere. And I've been asked to fill you in on examples across the country where states have taken bad situations, perpetual budget crises, and turn them around and created really good, sustainable systems for the future. Well, that reminds me of a story that was once told about Calvin Coolidge before he was president. He was having dinner with a group, and the woman next to him said, "What do you do?" And he said, "Well, I'm the Lieutenant Governor of Massachusetts." And she said, "Well, tell me all about it." And he said, "I just did." So I just gave you the list of states that have done huge structural changes. But that's okay, because incremental changes are very important too, and they can open the door for a lot more. There is no state that you can describe as paradise when it comes to having a revenue system and a budget process that works perfectly. I'm actually told the state that does it the best is Hawaii, and I'm trying to get a field trip in the budget so I can go there and see it for myself. But some states do some things better than other states do. And that's true with both revenue and other budget policies. So let me talk about some of that for a little bit. And you've heard a lot of good stuff already. I got to cross out a lot of things I wanted to say, so I'll even be briefer than I would have been. Income tax. As you found out earlier today, most states have an income tax. Most states that have one have a graduated income tax. Only a few states, like Illinois, have a flat income tax, which completely prevents you from making sure the wealthiest people, the people whose incomes are growing while everyone else is shrinking, get a chance to pay their fair share. And you know, this is important too, and I'll talk more about it. When rich people don't want to pay taxes, they don't say, I don't want to pay taxes, right? They say, oh, if you raise my taxes, it'll be bad for you, because I won't create jobs, or I'll leave. So what a lot of this comes down to isn't just the policy. As Jerry pointed out earlier, it's about the narrative. We heard a lot about that just a minute ago. And I want to talk about that, too, about how we can connect the dots to tell people the story. Because, you know, all too often, in a state like Illinois, where you are in a perpetual and getting worse budget crisis, it's too easy for folks to say, well, I don't know. I woke up this morning. The sun came up. The bus came. Well, what's the problem? You know, and so we have to help people really, really understand that. So one of the great things about an income tax is it's based on ability to pay. Most state taxes are not. Sales taxes or local property taxes, they're not based on your ability to pay. So the income tax has fairness going for it. One of the criticisms we often hear about it these days is, oh, but in a bad economy, revenue from the income tax just drops like crazy. Well, yeah, no tax system is going to do well when the economy is tanking. But the other thing about an income tax is when the economy gets better, receipts from the income tax tend to rise faster than the growth in the economy. So what it loses at one end, it can more than make up at the other end. And one of the best pieces of advice as any state can have about a tax system is similar to the advice for a stock portfolio: diversify. You heard earlier that while Illinois has an income tax, it relies much too little on it compared to what it could. you heard a bit about the sales tax, too. Just to amplify that, of the 45 states that have a sales tax, more and more states are taxing more and more services because, as you heard, the economy has changed, and if you're going to keep up with that, you have to do that. Well, on average, states tend to tax about 50 consumer services. Illinois taxes 5. Okay. Now, Ralph made a good point. Yes, sales taxes to some extent fall more heavily on people the lower their income is. But when you expand the sales tax to include more services, you actually take care of some of that problem. Because today, for example, you might pay sales tax on laundry detergent, but if you take your clothes to the cleaner, you don't pay tax. You pay sales tax if you buy a lawnmower, but you don't pay tax if you have a landscaper come to your house. So actually, by moving more sales taxes to services, it doesn't just reflect the changes in the economy today, it also helps make sure that affluent people are getting the opportunity to pay more in sales tax than they do today. I want to go back to the income tax again for one second because there's something that people often don't understand. And in a state like Illinois with a flat tax, it doesn't even come up. But as you move toward having a graduated income tax in Illinois, which is absolutely a good idea and should be encouraged, take a look at states where they have high top rates. You'll see, for example, New Jersey, I like to speak of because before I came to the center, I started and ran an organization in New Jersey called New Jersey Policy Perspective, and we're responsible. We started a coalition that led to an 8.7 top rate. And people say, 8.7 top rate? That's incredibly high. And what people don't understand is that's the top rate on every dollar you make above $500,000, not the money you make below $500,000. It's an income tax increase on something like 1% of the people in the state. And it provides a fair amount of money because those people are doing pretty well. So those are things to keep in mind, too. Yes, Minnesota did do a great job of raising the top rate, and that's one of the directions states are going these days. If you have a graduated income tax, you can say, well, let's have an income tax that better reflects the depressing reality of our economy, that so few people at the top are making so much of all the income growth. Well, with a graduated income tax, you can say, well, let's raise that. So some states have done that. The most recent state to establish an income tax, by the way, was Connecticut in 1990. And the most recent, the only state ever to eliminate an income tax was Alaska, which did so in the 1980s. And now the new governor says, we need the income tax back. He said, I could lay off every state employee in Alaska and it would not end our budget deficit. So kind of like Illinois, only a little bit colder. let's see, where am I going here? These things can be hard to change. You go back to the sales tax. No business is saying, oh, please add the sales tax to the product that I sell. But states are doing it. You know, states have added the sales tax to more services. And you know what? Health clubs and pet groomers have not gone out of business. People who are willing to pay for that service are willing to pay another nickel or 6 cents per dollar on paying for that service. It's just not that big of an issue. Other things Illinois could do along those lines, taxing internet downloads for sure. Illinois is a state that hasn't caught on to this interesting little scam. Travel companies like Orbitz and Priceline, you know, they pay a relatively small amount for hotel rooms, and then you pay a larger amount when you buy it through them, but they only pay sales tax based on that lower amount, not on what you pay. That's an easy loophole to fix, although there will be people who say we shouldn't do it. So most of the changes we're seeing today around taxes involve, yes, making a graduated income tax more graduated, trying to make a flat tax graduated. We're hoping to see that happen in Illinois. Massachusetts is also working on it. Colorado, unfortunately, lost at the ballot a year or two ago on that. Expanding the sales taxes to more services, for sure, and closing a lot of tax loopholes for businesses. Illinois is one of the states that adopted something called single sales factor. A lot of states levy a tax on corporations based on how much they sell in the state, how much property they have in the state, and how much payroll they have. Some states, like Illinois, switched that to only taxing what they sell in the state. They said, because that'll make businesses want to come here. Well, no state that has switched to that has gained money as a result of it, and when businesses want to leave, they leave anyway. So getting rid of that loophole would be a good one. So in talking about taxes, I'm kind of talking about the somewhat sexy side of fiscal issues. Now let me talk about the more boring side just for a minute, though. Budget process. One of my colleagues at the center put together a scorecard of how states rank in various aspects of the day-to-day putting together the budget in a way that's open, accountable, and fair. And she found that there were only three states in the country that scored lower than Illinois. They happen to be New Jersey, South Dakota, and Oklahoma. But these are the kinds of things Illinois could do. When you're making revenue projections to do the next budget, don't predict the next year. Predict the next 5 years so you get a better sense of what things are going to cost. Similarly, a lot of legislation has to include with it what they call a fiscal note. It says, this is how much this legislation will cost or save the state. But don't require that for the next year. Require it for the next 5 years so people have a better sense. What they call a current service budget, which really just means how much would it cost to deliver services at the same level next year or 5 years from now, knowing, for example, that maybe it's a service that helps senior citizens. Well, in 5 years from now, will there be more senior citizens in the state or will there be fewer? This will help you understand a lot better what things are going to cost. Developing a consensus way in the state to estimate what revenue is going to be. By consensus, I mean not just the governor and the legislature together, so there can be agreement on that. And another thing, which I don't think Illinois is quite ready to do yet because you have some catch up, but a rainy day fund, a reserve fund for when things get bad, that is fully funded and sustainable and ready to be used when the bad times come. Now, sometimes the pushback on some of these things is, oh, you know, you're trying to take the politics out of the budget and you can't do that. Well, you can't do that and you shouldn't do that. Debates over priorities about where a state should go are very important to have. But the kinds of reforms we're talking about here mean they can be debates where everybody starts with the same facts. Let's have honest debates about priorities and the direction the state should go, not debates about what the facts are. Let's debate the policy and let the technicalities be worked out. There have been some reforms in these areas, in some areas. The legislature in New Jersey just recently passed a measure requiring consensus revenue forecasting with the legislature and the governor together. Now, in a prior life, I worked for a governor of New Jersey, and we would not have wanted to share revenue forecasting with anybody, and apparently Governor Christie doesn't either because he just vetoed that bill. In Connecticut, the state comptroller introduced a proposal to strengthen the rainy day funds in their state. In Missouri, a state senator has proposed a measure that would require current service budgeting, projecting the cost of things out in future years. So all these things are important, and you know, don't give up because you can only get a little at a time, because each of those little changes can, in fact, be the wedge that opens the door for larger things. So I hope people don't get discouraged about that. I think another thing that's important to talk to you all as advocates about, and I've done a fair share of advocating myself, is that what's also important is not just the policy changes, but how you set the stage for those policy changes to take place. We heard about that just a couple minutes ago, and let me see what I can add to that. Like I said, Jerry talked about changing the narrative. You know, think back to the history of this country. Think back about the middle to late 1990s. We had this debate over welfare at the national level. But it was the wrong debate. It was a debate over how you fixed a system that was broken. It wasn't a debate over whether the system was even broken. Or the people today who want to have a debate about how to replace Social Security because it's failed. Not a debate over, has it failed? Well, my point is, when someone else gets there first and sets the terms for the debate, you've already lost, or you have to fight extra hard not to lose. So what we're talking about here is connect the dots for people. Tell them what this is all about. What you said before was fantastic. Don't just say, stop the cuts. You know, positive reinforcement. Don't just tell people what they shouldn't do. Help them understand what they should do. Tax the rich, raise revenue, understand what the problem really is. And I think that is very important, and we all have a role to play in that. This is a role you play as advocates, as legislators, but even as friends and neighbors. It's the pushback you tell the person next door when they say, oh, all government's full of waste and fraud. You know, don't let that stuff stand, because that's how we got where we are today. Rational economists, rational public officials, and I know there are a lot of irrational ones in all those areas too, they know what to do to make this tax system better. The numbers that you heard today, the people who oppose the things you want, they know those numbers too. So it isn't the numbers that change people's minds. The numbers certainly help make us confident that we are right, that what we believe in is supported by facts, and they help us to develop that narrative, but it's really the narrative that matters the most. Just a tiny bit of history here. You know, that Illinois native, Ronald Reagan, when he ran for president in 1980, he said, if we cut taxes, the economy will grow. We'll actually collect more revenue in taxes if we cut them because of the economic growth. It's called supply-side economics. It's been thoroughly discredited economically, politically. It lives on. Arthur Laffer, who invented it, goes all around the country now getting paid by governors to tell them how to, 1 minute remaining, wow, telling them how to cut taxes in their states. So that's something that has to be pushed back against. Okay, I'm going to end with a very quick laundry list. Here are the kinds of things we have to get into the public discourse. Okay? Number one, tax rates play a negligible role in business decisions on where to locate. Okay? In most states, they account to 1% to 2% of the taxes that a business pays. Number two, cutting business taxes does not promote job growth. For that reason I just gave you, and also because any smart business person knows, I hire people when the demand for what I sell is up, no matter what my taxes are, and I don't hire them when it's not up, no matter how much you cut my taxes. Number three, raising taxes on the wealthy has never lost money for any state. When we did the millionaire's tax in New Jersey, folks said, oh, the rich, they're all going to leave. You're going to see caravans of BMWs and Lexuses with cases of Perrier strapped to their roof, all leaving the state, you know? So finally, some Princeton economists got around to doing a study, and they said, well, you know what? After that, when you raise that tax on people making over $500,000, you lost $1 billion from people who left the state. But you know what? That's nothing compared to how much you gained from people who didn't leave the state. So the point is, the money is in the fact that very few people leave from one state to another during the course of the year anyway, and they certainly don't go in droves when you do that. They have reasons why they live where they live. Another one, the fastest job growth in states we're finding comes from homegrown startups, not from companies that move in. So all these huge deals that states are offering to businesses to get them to come, they don't do much good at all. I can remember one time sitting in the office of the New Jersey State Senate Minority Leader, just the two of us, and he said to me, he said, John, I know that all these tax breaks we give to businesses don't do anything, but I will never say so publicly. Okay, that was interesting. One more. Not only do tax cuts not help job growth, they hurt it. Because when you cut taxes for businesses or anybody else, you are cutting the ability to make the public investments in the things that really do create jobs and build a strong economy. Schools, transportation, safe communities, you name it. Last point, I think this is really important to push back on people. The money that states take in from taxes pretty much goes right back out into the economy. It goes back out in the form of salaries, purchases, assistance for people. So when folks make it sound as though they think that the state takes money in from taxes and then runs it through a shredder, right, or stashes it in the Cayman Islands, we need to help make sure that people understand that a job is a job, whether it's a public sector job or a private sector job. Have you ever seen a store with two separate cash registers, one for the public sector employee, one for the private sector? There's only one economy, and any way you can make it grow is a good way. So let me just conclude by saying that sometimes the people we have to start with in all this is our allies, or the people who should be our allies, because we have to help the people who agree with us on what needs to be, on the problem, understand how to make that problem an issue that politicians have to deal with. So part of our message to folks has to be something like this. Do you want to fight among yourselves for the crumbs of a pie that's shrinking? You know, do you want to be the first one to get to the crumbs because you beat somebody else, or do you want to make the pie bigger? So this state can be the kind of state that you really want it to be, a state where there's opportunity and a good future for everyone. Thank you.
All right, well, this is dealing with healthcare, so it's of interest to health and medicine about the media bias against the ACA. That when there is any bad news to report, insurance premiums, things of that nature, that's what we see. But there's much less coverage of things that benefit the public, like a lower uninsurance, higher numbers of people with insurance, and things of that nature. So I'll throw that out there and see if you have any thoughts on that, because it's not exactly a budget issue, but it's certainly important as we look at what government can do and how those sorts of stories undermine our confidence in government.
Yeah, and I've covered the ACA, but it's been a little while. I think part of that is probably the lack of as many dedicated healthcare reporters who are tracking, you know, what's going on with the ACA on a regular basis. So if you're kind of a general assignment, you tend to just do those stories that, you know, you feel like you need to check in with it every so often, which is enrollment numbers and what people are going to be paying for their insurance. So, you know, one way to maybe make a difference there would be to reach out to when you see those stories, and it's someone who maybe isn't a dedicated healthcare reporter, to reach out to them, because maybe, you know, they aren't spending a lot of time on that issue and they're covering lots of other things, to give them, you know, more options for those stories, because sometimes we're just kind of trying to squeeze in, oh, we got to cover the Affordable Care Act today, but we're doing six other things. So that can be a big issue. I'm not sure that I would call it I don't feel like there's the strong undercurrent of bias that reporters hate the ACA or we think it's bad or anything like that. It's more those are the stories that we feel like have to get done, that are those number stories and the stories that we feel like our general audience will want to know, how much is my insurance going to cost? You know, those are the real basic things. So reaching out and kind of trying to help folks take it beyond that when we're not dedicated healthcare reporters would be a way to tackle that.
Thank you.
All right, great, thank you. And then one last question about healthcare in particular, and that is how the budget crisis could be solved by implementing a single-payer healthcare system. This is a question I think is just in the deck permanently. No matter what the subject, no matter what the setting, venue, year, unfortunately, because it never goes away because we still don't have one. We only have one state in the country that has sort of adopted it as a future goal. And does anybody want to address that? Because I think it'd be unfair to not at least have that question out there. There are some single payer advocates in the room here, so. Anybody? All right, well, I think let me.
If the question is, would it help immensely? The answer is yes. If the question is it going to happen anytime soon? The answer is probably not.
So if we have to look at how we're going to address this crisis that we're facing, the situation, there are some other things we should be working on at the same time people are working on single payer. Is that a good summary, Jerry? Press again.
I'll say something about that because each year, as I have the privilege of teaching at Northwestern, when we come to the topic in my social policy class of healthcare, the students almost universally get this. So perhaps there's hope for the next generation. I mean, there's just instinctively, it just comes up. Well, wouldn't it be better? And back to narrative, it's been shot down so aggressively by the stories that the insurance companies have put out there that most people in our generation are stuck. So back to John's point, which is if you don't shape the narrative, you're lost before you start.
Okay.
Let's go to the next one.
So, to the panel on the dealing with the spending side, how do we get out of the stalemate that we're in? We can't survive three more years like this. What do you see? And maybe any of you want to address this. What is possible. We didn't think we could survive 7 months, and we have. In the sense that we're still alive, there may be others who aren't, which is obviously the tragedy that we're facing. But what do you foresee happening in the next month, next few months? Anybody have any guesses?
Well, as you can imagine, I'm asked this question multiple times a day. And I wish I had a great answer for you. The problem is that we've never been in this place before, so it's very hard to know how it's going to end. Some people portray it as a fight between Madigan and Rauner. It's not. The legislature is a majority Democrat. We vote our districts. Our districts do not support the turnaround agenda. Actually, the governor took that turnaround agenda throughout the whole state, trying to get as many local governments as he could to support it. And I think out of 7,000, he got 3, something like that. So there is not really support in the whole state for his agenda. So even if we had a different Speaker of the House, the members still would not be voting for that turnaround agenda. I think that both sides feel like we're just going to wait each other out. We're not going to vote for it. He's not going to change his mind. I believe that we need to have more pressure on the governor. He's the one that was elected to lead. He's the one that was elected the governor. He needs to figure out a way to make this work. So I encourage everybody I talk to put more pressure on the governor, tell him that we need a budget, we don't support his turnaround agenda, and let's move forward.
Then related to that, I think, is the question about, is it enough to pressure the government? And you're suggesting within that the governor in particular, but how do we educate the public? Should we be talking about how to pressure and educate the corporate world? Take a mic.
Yes, this is the answer to that. Of course we should. But they are now starting to feel the pain as well. So those individuals are his friends that have invested in Illinois already are the ones who are losing money now. So they are the losers. Conversely, we can say that he's helping friends and that we all know him to be basically someone, and I think it was mentioned earlier by someone, that he's never built anything. So he's made his riches on tearing something down and then selling it and then counting his money, which seemingly is his plan here in the state of Illinois. So what happens is who is going to have to pay that price? The price is it's going to be the burden on us, because when we sell those bonds with those high interest rates, it's the taxpayers who are actually paying those dollars. So I think his friends or the people that are on that level are going to be the ones that are going to be recognizing that there is a difference, and so there's going to have to be some changes made.
John and William, you see a lot of erosion in Cranes, at least, of support for that. Cranes this week had two columns filling up the second page. But go ahead, John.
I'm more used to asking questions than answering them. That was, by the way, Senator, an excellent description of the private equity business. I appreciate that. But I ask questions rather than answer them, and I like to put people on the hot seat sometimes. So. Robin and Donnie, there was a brief period before the governor was sworn in that the legislature and the leadership had an opportunity to renew the income tax surcharge. They elected not to. What were they thinking?
The governor asked us not to do it. What he said to the legislature was, I know there's an issue here. I want to address it. I'm going to work on it when I get in. So please don't pass anything before I get in.
I'm not necessarily one to defend. Let's be clear that when we got the income tax, there was zero Republican votes for it. And thus, the Republicans who all the state benefited ended up beating Democrats on the head 2 years for passing a state income tax increase. Politically speaking, the Democrats should not have to shoulder all the burden for passing tax increase. The whole state benefits, and everybody should be putting in. And Madigan's response was, he wants to make sure that everybody in the state, Republican and Democrat, have a chance to weigh in on the revenue side as well as the side. Republicans are pretty good at weighing in on the cut side, need to be just as responsible at weighing in on the spending side as well.
So that still assumes that the public narrative is against taxes and adequate taxation, and that anybody who votes for it is going to be vulnerable. And if all the Democrats in the General Assembly vote for it, some in those transitional districts will be more vulnerable and penalized by a public that doesn't want to see their taxes increase. So it seems to me that the issue boils down, as some people here are asking, is to the changing narrative. What is the process for civic education? What is the process for reaching those corporations? And how do other states do it? Because these states that you showed on the maps, both of the slides, those are the red states with higher taxes, progressive taxes. What do those legislators see? And what does the public in those states recognize that our system here doesn't highlight?
I wish I could say that vote to
wait, could you take another mic? I think yours is cutting in and out, at least from what I'm hearing here.
I wish I could tell you that it was an easy road to grassroots work and to do grassroots educating. Amisha just highlighted all of the things that she is doing in the community on a daily basis, and slowly but surely, more and more people are being educated about this. People are here being educated about it. It's to get to this point. It's going to maybe take us a year, 2 years, 3 years to get beyond this point. But the good news is, Mike, is that we're all out here, us involved in advocacy, are not only trying to lobby the legislators who pretty much know what's going on, but we must make sure that the public has the opportunity to understand and know what's going on. That's on us as advocates to change this narrative. Misha, in her hope, in the end of her presentation, did a wonderful job of talking about the grassroots stuff that is going on. And change doesn't come in on the wheels of inevitability. Somebody has to drive that inevitability. And we in the advocacy side are doing the best we can. And we'll get there.
But I just wanted to say two things about this. One is that no legislator was voted out of office who voted for the tax increase. So that narrative needs to get out there. Nobody was unelected because they voted for the tax increase.
I think another thing, you know, it's right. We do have to do deep grassroots education, mobilization that is happening. We need more of it. I think the fact that, again, more people voted for a millionaire's tax, every county in the state, right? I mean, like this idea of like the people who want are ready to tax the wealthy or Chicago folks or up, you know, up north, like it's just actually not true. So there is a will of voters who want to see this work happen. And I do think there's lots of work for all of us to do. And I think what the Democrats have done well is been really very clear about holding the line against Rahner's anti-union agenda and not letting that turnaround agenda actually move forward, to not like let him continue to hold the budget hostage because of that. And I do also think, though, we do need Democrats to be greater champions for progressive revenue solutions. That is what people want. The voters are looking for change, they're looking for actually solutions, and we do have to figure out how to move forward. So the defense is important, but we also have to have champions that are pushing forward progressive revenue solutions. And I think there is the will across the state of people want to see that work happen. We all know there's a lot, there's a new norm of dysfunctionality across our state, right? We're kind of getting used to the fact that things are just like, that things suck. And it's a problem, right? Like, and I think what's been really powerful about the education work we've done is that it like fires up, it mobile, like people just are like, I didn't know this. Like, I didn't know that this was the setup. I didn't know that this was how, like why we're in this mess that we're in. Because what we get told is that it's our fault. Not that all of this is the reason of what's happening. And so I think doing that work is really critical. We're going to continue to also, you know, educate the base, but we also want to have our elected officials be champions for these issues.
I just want to add one thing, and it's a little more global, but I think it pertains. Life for middle-class people in this country for a number of years has really been bad. And this country moves when the middle moves. And the middle moves because it got pushed from one side or the other side. And the unfortunate reality over the course of now several decades is that the middle has been moved by the side who says, let me give you an explanation for why your life is so bad. Your life is so bad because government takes all your money and gives it to poor people. Well, there's another narrative there. Your life is so bad because rich people are taking all your money, and so they don't have to pay their fair share. You're getting cuts in education and tuition's going up, et cetera, et cetera. So I feel like it won't happen tomorrow, but it's what these efforts are all about, to help people understand there is a reason and there is a villain. It's just not the one you thought it was. And I think we have to do that. And, you know, there was a day, I think, in some states where fights over the budget were really good-intentioned people really wondering what should be the rate of the taxes, which tax should we have here. Now it's a battle between people who want to do what's right and people who think there shouldn't be taxes, there shouldn't be government. And you can't win a fight unless you know you're in one. And so I think that kind of organizing and advocacy and narrative is really, really important.
You're absolutely correct. Well, no, you're in a fight. You're in one. I know. Let me see.
Here, give me that.
Yeah. Because the thing is, the general population has been lulled into this tranquil type of setting, because as pointed out earlier, the judiciary was our friend. 89.4% of everybody is getting paid. So this big crisis that we've been talking about for the past 7 months, the majority of people said, I don't see anything different. I don't know what's going on. So we have to, again, get that message out, because it's now that we're seeing this 10% that is not covered by consent decree not covered because it's not unconstitutional are going to get the brunt of everything, and it's going to be a shock to them because they've been saying it hasn't been that bad. So unless we're into letting that 10% suffer so they can be the example for the other 90% of individuals who are not suffering because of the assistance of the courts, then we have to get busy to get that message out right now, because there is going to be, as we always talk about, that cliff, and that 10% is standing right there on the edge of going over, and hopefully that doesn't have to happen before action is taken.
Yeah. I just wanted to say that Amisha's emphasis on the millionaire's tax is very important. And to answer your question, Michael, in many cases, the states that have been able to increase revenues in recent years, states like California and Minnesota, have done so in a progressive tax environment. It was difficult. I mean, in California, there was a referendum process. It was a very hard battle, but taxes were increased, but only because they had this graduated system, and the people decided that the fair thing to do was to impose higher taxes on wealthier people. We don't have that option in this state until we pass a constitutional amendment like the one for millionaires tax. And that's why I come back to the need to really think hard about whether that's the place we want to put our resources.
Well, there was a question here about which should we do first? The graduated income tax, higher corporate tax rates, or other tax reforms? Is it an and rather than an or?
Is that a question? Here.
You start.
Well, I was just going to say that I think it is easier to make changes that are not constitutional amendments first, and that we should start with that, but at the same time continue to educate the public about the progressive income tax. And I just spoke with some folks the other day about it. The problem is that in order to get that passed, we will need to vote on it, and we will need to get two-thirds or three-quarters of the people in the state to say yes. And in order to get them to say yes, it's going to take three-fifths. It's going to take a lot of education, a huge social movement, and it's not going to happen overnight. So I feel like that is something. But on the other hand, you have to keep talking about it. Because if you stop talking about it, people will forget about it. And this needs to be something that people talk about all the time, and that there becomes more and more and more discussion about it, rather than going in these cyclical things. Well, we can't get it on the ballot this year, so we shouldn't talk about it. No, we need to continue to talk about it.
Yeah. And Mike, you talked about, should we do the corporate tax and do the personal income tax? They have to be done together. I mean, as a legislator, I mean, if I'm a vote for a tax, let's do it all at one time instead of trying to do something another 6 months down the line, because the general population really doesn't understand. Just because they're not engaged, they have their own lives they have to live, and entrust us to do their work for them in Springfield. So the thing is they need to know that this is what it's going to be and going forward. And the last time when we had the temporary tax, Jerry, you know, as you will, and Brian, I mean, even though we knew it was temporary, it should have been more in the first place. You know what I mean? It's so good. But after we started into that tax, we couldn't raise it again because we just did it.
And not expire.
Right.
So quickly.
And not make it expire, but we knew. Well, that was...
I know.
Whatever it was. It was unnecessary.
I'd like to say that with respect to corporate income tax loopholes, it's important that the people in this room advocate in front of the Revenue Committee of the House and of the Senate. You know, my sense is that so many advocates, they devote their time to the Human Services Committee or the Appropriations Committee, and that's well and good, but they also need to come to the Revenue Committees and talk to the members of the Revenue Committees. I mean, I can't tell you how many times I was before the Revenue Committees during my time, and it was kind of me against the world. And although I try to be persuasive, the hard work is on the revenue side. I think we've all come to understand that, and it means devoting our attention to the revenue committees and the members of the General Assembly that really focus on revenue issues.
Let me add one reflection, and that is being in California during the proposition battles, which is almost every year, every general election, and we talk, putting this in the context of how do you communicate with the public, the citizen ballot initiative process there engages people in a way that we don't do here. I mean, there is occasionally the paid-for constitutional amendment or whatever the issue was that was circulating, but these are paid people who are just out there to get signatures on a ballot referendum or something of that nature. But in California, during those debates, every time you walked out of a grocery store, every time you stood at a bus stop, every time there were people congregating anywhere, there were volunteers, some of them paid certainly, but there were that engaged a volunteer group who said this is the right thing to do, and they went out. They weren't so much door to door in California as we might be here in an urban environment, but they are there. They were everywhere, and that you couldn't, every time you turn on the TV, there was a commercial, so there was no getting away from it. And I think what the panel is reflecting on a little bit is that in Illinois, most people are insulated from all these issues. There is totally getting away from it instead of being engaged in it. And that's one of the things that a constitutional amendment process might actually benefit us through the engagement. But that's my own editorializing.
That
Robin, did you
happens,
press your button? Did that mean
Michael, when the Constitution provides for that sort of citizen engagement. So my sense would be that the next time the question of should there be a constitutional convention to look at the entire Constitution, well, a lot of us are worried about, oh my gosh, then they'll open up this can of worms, that can of worms, that, but that would be the time to raise that question were there to be a constitutional convention.
No, that's absolutely right. And I just to clarify, I was limiting us to our current constitution. A constitutional amendment to create a progressive tax increase might be the way to engage the public.
But that'll only get on the ballot if the legislature puts it on.
It's got to, yeah, right.
And they'll only put it on if there's pressure from the grassroots.
Correct. Could I make one more point
please.
About the earlier question, which is, what are the steps to get out of this current quagmire? And it might be interesting to reflect on what Senator Trotter said, well, because why there's not intense pressure is most of the things are actually operating. While they're operating at a great deficit, they're operating. When that downstate court ruled that state employees should be paid, ooh, the pressure went off. But why did they rule that way, and why did nobody challenge them? Because members of both parties in the legislature were for that, especially those who have facilities, et cetera, in their districts. And then nobody challenged the constitutionality of what the judge ruled. So all the pressure went off. For those areas that weren't appropriately funded, you know, we've seen then the second set of decisions, which is, for example, on the child care, a lot of pressure on a single topic. I wonder whether, again, what Senator Trotter raised, which is, hey, there's been no appropriation for higher education. The MAP grants aren't funded, and congratulations to the courage of the leaders of Chicago State University for saying, hey, we're going to have to close, which is a very painful thing for anybody to say. But I think we all should rally around now that new pressure point, because members of both parties may, in fact, get interested in that and put something on the governor's desk that he would then have the pressure to sign. So one by one, we may get out of the quagmire.
And thank you. It is more than one. My message to them is they have to build these coalitions. There's five universities that are getting ready to close and within the next 4 months. Chicago State, Northeastern Illinois University, Governor State, Eastern Illinois, and Western Illinois are all right there because they do not have the reserves to go forward. And this is even without them trying to assist and promise and pay for those MAP grants. This is just all everyday operational dollars.
Although the danger of that approach is that we may end up bankrupting the state, right? So
we're clearly bankrupting the state at $25 billion in the hole. That's where we're going.
And states can't go bankrupt. And states can't go bankrupt, right?
Maybe not as a legal matter, but at some point we need to get a holistic solution here. And I guess my concern is that we deal with these problems kind of one by one, and so the deficit just grows bigger and bigger until things could really collapse in the state. So I don't know what the answer is, but it's a problem.
But there are those landmines out there in this process that we're in where Western Illinois folds or threatens to fold. And it isn't just the folding, it's the announcement that the problem is so severe that it might, that creates the exodus of the key staff, faculty, student applications. I mean, it's a huge avalanche of disaster that takes decades to rebuild. So to use it as a lever is a very dangerous undertaking, but it isn't necessarily being used that way. But you know, when we try to think of what's going to bring Rauner to the table, or the Republicans that think what's going to bring Madigan to the table, they look for these landmines that might explode that would cause some sort of disruption of the status quo. And certainly the university system, because it is throughout the state, is one of the possibilities. William?
The reason I started off my presentation listing all of the cuts and the people that were affected, and I painstakingly did that, is because the people that they affect, for the most part, aren't in this room, but once you know it, you're outraged by it. So, and that's because I still believe on this day, which is Martin Luther King's actual birthday, we are talking about economic fairness. Martin Luther King said, too many people of goodwill have never connected bigotry with economic exploitation. They deplore prejudice, but on the other hand, they ignore or tolerate economic injustice. But he concluded by saying, these two evils have a malignant kinship. He understood that economic rights were just as central to his vision as civil and political rights, because you can't have racial justice without economic justice, and you cannot have a democracy without both. And so if our country is supposed to be a democracy and not just a corporate state, then its people must have freedom, and not just freedom of assembly or freedom of speech or freedom of religion, but freedom from hunger and freedom from want and freedom from poverty. Thus, one definition of democracy is shared prosperity. And the reason that this is so central to us today is I truly believe that this is a battle for the soul of our state. And one of the most single important progressive policy to retain jobs and take care of the common good is to pass tax reform that raise enough revenues to adequately fund public services, those who are provided by the government and those who are dependent on public support. So lastly, it's gotta be bigger than partisan politics. There are some Republicans, if we put enough pressure on, that want to do the right thing. The reason that child care got funded in the first place was not because somebody ran from one plantation to the other. The reason that child care services got funded in the first place, that was a myth, is because Republicans put pressure on Bruce Rauner to do something about this, and it was going to pass anyway, and he had to restore that funding. They can only win if we are divided. Black versus white, citizen versus immigrant, union workers versus human services, straight against gay, as of today, let us knit that inescapable garment of destiny that King talked about. Well, what affects one of us directly affects all of us indirectly. And I did not want to miss that opportunity on this day, Dr. King's birthday, to remind us that we have more in common than we have apart, and we can solve these problems, and we don't have to piecemeal it. If we come together, there's nothing we can't do here in Illinois.
All right, well, that would be a perfect ending to any gathering on this day. But let me just ask in the last few minutes about what efforts are going on and what we should be doing to engage this group, what you can all be doing to engage your groups, your organizations. And it isn't just where you work, because I suspect all of us, I've worked among friendly people in my career, but I don't necessarily live among friendly people. And it's so easy to say, well, we do our politics at work. We don't need to knock on doors to see how our friends and neighbors are doing. But that's how we're going to change this, I think. Like any political movement, this has to be a movement. This isn't going to happen by experts saying, we've got these charts and look how bad this is. If it was going to happen with data, it would have happened already. So it's got to happen through the public discourse, through the engagement, through the narrative. And we're way behind on that battle, but we can have forums like this every year for the next 10, 15, 20 years if we don't catch up and move ahead. So who would want to say what's happening next in their communities or that their organizations are ready to move ahead? Amisha, I see your green light there.
I won't repeat what I've already said. Well, I'll repeat it a little bit. There's a lot of folks in motion. You can reach out to us to get plugged into any of those campaigns that are moving forward. If you're connected to a school, a church, mosque, temple, an organization that you want to have us come and train around how the economy is the way that it is, we're happy to do that. I think the main thing is that we've got to have conversations, we've got to connect, and we've got to figure out how to continue to build power. As long as we believe that there is nothing that we can do, as long as we have that feeling of hopelessness and despair, nothing will change. It will continue to be the way that it is. And I think the point of what is happening right now, I think the themes of today is that there are a lot of solutions. It's a myth that this idea that there's nothing that we can do. There's a lot of folks in motion. Plug in, find out what's happening, reach out to us, and get involved with any of the campaigns that are happening.
The Citizen Action is currently involved in a project called Illinois Rights at Work. Basically, we believe that there are certain rights that every worker should have, whether they're unionized or not. It was actually started as a response to the turnaround agenda. So we're going around educating people about what the turnaround agenda is, what it actually means. Is it really not reform? What it is an attempt to take away the rights of workers and drive wages up as opposed to down. And we break that down. But we also offer not only information, maybe something you may not have known before, but we also offer instruction. We have a C3 and a C4, so a lot of our instruction is political at the very least. We talk about civic engagement and voter registration and getting out the vote. And those who want to be hard at edge, we basically say who we think the real enemy is, or the real opponent is. And lastly, not only do we offer information, but we offer instruction. Hopefully we also offer inspiration, which means that if we can stop being a little less cynical, a little cynicism is healthy, too much kills the spirit, and a little bit more hopeful and optimistic that we can change things. Hopefully we provide that as well. If conservatives hate government in theory and liberals hate it in practice, we're never going to get anybody to want to pay taxes. So let's be hopeful about what government can do. And we stand ready to do that as well.
Robin and Donnie, any advice about as the legislative session approaches here, what we can try to do differently than we've done before, better, or leadership issues, or stray members that need to be, whose spirit needs to be enhanced? Who should we sick William on?
The Republicans. No, I think that we need to put pressure on, we need to talk to all the legislators, not only leadership, and just continue to do it. I mean, I think the legislators want a resolution to this. They want a resolution to it. So I, you know, I kind of stand by my pressure the governor line. I think that he is really the one holding things up. And I think that, in, as William said, the Republicans were able to change his mind, that to move him forward. So I do think that at this point in time, the Republicans have a little more ability to pressure the governor. I have to tell you that I came to that conclusion that the business community has to step out and help us. And I was encouraged by Crane's articles talking about that the business community is pretty fed up. So I actually reached out to a couple of friends of Rauner, because Rauner lives in my district, you know, other his friends do as well. And I know some of them who are actually have a social conscience. So I put some calls into them to see if they would talk to the governor. I'm thinking maybe he'll listen to them. And needless to say, I did not get any calls back. So, and then Crane's made a lot of sense in their most recent article where they said, well, you know what? He's not gonna, he didn't need any of them to get elected. He doesn't owe them anything. He is, no, there's no reason he's gonna listen to them either. So, and I think they're all a little scared of him too. So, by two, I mean the Republicans. Obviously, I'm not scared of him. I have nothing to lose, so. you know, he does like to breed fear into people's hearts.
And there's a lot of money at stake, as that slide showed. He himself saved $750,000, and his friend saved multiple millions of dollars. And so this is a real issue. This is, I think, John, your article a couple of months ago talked about the ideological base for Rauner's willingness to run for office and interest in willingness to run for office. Many of the rich guys wanted to change things, but Rauner was the one who put himself forward. He had the money to do it. He did it. And now we see what his goal is, and we have to be energized to overcome that, because they have a lot of money out there to get their message out. Any other final comments? Let me thank you all, but before you leave, there's a summary being prepared. This camera is recording some of this for CAN TV, so we welcome our CAN TV audience, if you're hearing this. And your interest, and applaud your interest in being here and doing your part to share these efforts to get the message out to the public. And Health and Medicine will have a written summary on our website, and it'll be a notice of which will be sent to all the people who registered for this. And we can keep the dialogue going on the web and through Twitter and other electronic means. And I really want to thank all of our panelists. Here, you see their names. I don't have to go through them again, but you guys did a fantastic job of getting your message out quickly, concisely. And to thank you for spending all of us together, and for you spending so much time of your day at this forum. So that concludes the forum. Thank you again. There'll be another one in a few months in the Health and Medicine's continuing series.